I'm Councilmember Eddie Tejeda. It gives me great pleasure to introduce you to our second annual Dia de los Muertos celebration at AK Smiley Library in Redlands, California. This year, you will travel with us to visit families in the Redlands area who celebrate reuniting with their loved ones. Additionally, you will observe some beautiful altars created by Redlands organizations and service clubs. This is our way to celebrate El Dia de los Muertos in Redlands during these COVID-19 pandemic times. Dia de los Muertos has deep roots in pre-Columbian Mesoamerica, where rituals were held to honor the dead. Over 3,000 years ago, the Aztecs and the Nahua people living in central Mexico believed death was an integral and present part of life. They believed that the gates of heaven opened at midnight on October 31st, where the deceased were reunited with their families. The three-day celebration from October 31st to November 2nd is celebrated in Mexico, Central America, South America, the United States, and Latino communities throughout the world. Families build ofrendas, or altars, and visit the grave sites of the deceased. The altars are decorated in vibrant colors. They include candles, flowers, favorite foods, and drinks of the deceased. Many altars have pictures of the deceased along with a favorite item or toy. The belief is that these special items help guide their loved ones' souls as they return to the living during the celebration. Please join me in the celebration of Dia de los Muertos.
Feliz Dia de los Muertos! I'm Chris.
And I'm Christina.
And this is an ofrenda.
An ofrenda is a traditional celebration de Dia de los Muertos. This tradition is supposed to offer late family members those things that they used to enjoy in life.
La ofrenda is rich in colors, flavors, and aromas.
Ancient Mexican cultures, Olmecas, Mayas, but especially Aztecs, used to believe that by honoring the souls of the dead, their spirits would stay close for protection. In their ofrendas, the Aztec people would put clay utensils and obsidian blades that the deceased had used to hunt or in times of war.
But it wasn't until after the Spanish conquista that the festivity of Dia de los Muertos started being celebrated on the first days of November. Some of the main components of the ofrenda are related to the ancient four elements. Agua, on a white tablecloth that represents purity, we put a glass of water to quench the thirst of souls.
Veladoras, candles to symbolize fire, to guide the deceased in the dark.
Papel picado, this wonderful and colorful paper symbolizes the presence of the wind.
Cempasúchil, that means flowers of 400 petals, is a traditional yellow flower that represents the element of the earth.
The family members that we will be honoring are my grandma and grandpa.
La comida. My dad said that they used to like chocolate, pan dulce, arroz, mole, and a little bit of wine. Calaveras de azúcar. Sugar skulls with the names of our family members on them.
Pan de muerto is a special kind of bread prepared for these occasions.
With a combination of Spanish and ancient Mexico's beliefs, the celebration of Dia de los Muertos merged with the elements of those two cultures to honor and remember late family members.
That's what an ofrenda is all about.
Buenos días.
Buenos días.
¿Y cuál es su nombre, señor?
Irene Díaz Franco. Soy de México, del estado de Morelos. Y esta es la tradición de nuestro pueblo, de donde yo nací, donde yo estuve. Y todo lo que significa la ofrenda es La luz es para que los nuestros difuntos vayan con su lucecita. Como nos decía mi abuelito, Dios los manda como si fuera hoy su cumpleaños. Vienen a traer su luz, a traer su pan, a comer todo lo que a ellos les gustaba para poderse ir felices, satisfechos, que ya comieron. Eso es lo que para nosotros, los mexicanos, eso es lo que ha significado todo esto.
Uh-huh. Y allí tienen fotos ustedes de sus ahí, ser queridos.
Sí, ahí está mi abuelita con todos sus hijos, ya todos también son difuntos. Esta es mi abuelita, la mamá de mi papá, y esa es mi mamá. Pues a nosotros nos decía que ponerle todo lo que a ellos les gustaba, como era mi papá, le gustaba el cigarro, le compramos su cajetilla de cigarro, okay, su cerveza, uh-huh, y a mi abuelita le gustaba el café negro, puro cafecito, y así va toda la tradición, y el día de los difuntos chiquitos es el día primero. A ese se le ponen sus, bueno, allá el tejocote, arroz con leche, o lo que a ellos les gustaba, como era nosotros allá hasta canicas, como les gustaba, ajá, jugar canicas, pónganle la caniquita al niño y ahí le poníamos la canica. Y pues eso, a nosotros eso nos enseñó mi abuelito, y por eso desde que mi mamá y todos mis hermanos tenemos la tradición de lo que significa esto.
¿Qué es tejocote?
Mire, es un dulce, es un dulce, es uno como ciruela. Uh-huh. Ese se pone a hervir, se pela y ya se hace el dulce, la azúcar la pone uno a hervir. Y ya esos luego les pone uno a los niños chiquitos. Aquí como yo no tengo chiquitos, pues digo ya nomás yo les rezo y uh-huh, pero sí se les pone pues allá pues como había todo, la calabaza también, allá hay calabazas especiales para hacerla con dulce también.
¿Y cuánto tiempo tienen celebrando el Día de Muertos?
Mire, aquí mi hija nunca había hecho tan grande sus altares porque cuando no ha vivido en casa más chica, pero ya desde hace un año ya empezó ella, que sí les ponemos su veladora, pero de ahí para allá todo el tiempo. No igual, pero sí, gracias a Dios, mis hijas, aunque sea su lucecita y les han puesto, desde que están aquí siempre han seguido la tradición, sí, ellas.
¿Y usted en su país qué tanto lo celebraban cada año?
Cada año, porque como le digo, mi abuelito eso es lo que decía, que así como nosotros cumplimos años, ellos también cumplen años de difuntos. Eso es lo que se celebra, por eso vienen ellos a comerse lo que a ellos les gustaba. Uh-huh, uh-huh. Y pues como decían unas gentes, ¿no? Unas personas, pues la tradición es tradición, vengan o no vengan, pero para nosotros creemos que pues la alma, como dicen, anda todavía. Así de que pues nosotros eso es lo que siempre hemos tenido de devoción.
Uh-huh. ¿Y su mamá y sus abuelos también celebraban
sí,
la tradición?
No. Ahí con mi abuelito, este altarcito está chiquito, hacían más porque mi abuelito le ponía que a sus hermanos, que al hijo de su hermana, que era mucho, mucho, todo uh-huh, el tiempo.
Uh-huh. ¿Y hacían el altar también en el panteón?
No, en el panteón nada más ya se llevan las puras flores y la luz, pues porque allá ya ve que no está los panteones como aquí, allá está más rústico, hay más Sí, en este tiempo todas las personas van a limpiar sus panteones porque está muy feo, pues, pero ya ahora van y limpian sus panteones, arreglan para que ya el día que llevan su ofrenda allá, ya le llevan sus flores, sus veladoras. Ya dijera mi abuelito, ya lo demás ya se lo comieron.
Muy bien, muy bien. Carmen, ¿te gustaría compartir algo?
Mi nombre es Carmen Salas Díaz, nací en el estado de Morelos, México. La tradición fue de pasada de mis abuelitos, de mi mamá, de mis tías por parte de mamá. Como explicó mi mamá, aquí tenemos a mi abuelita que básicamente fue la que a todos nos inculcó la tradición de las posadas, Día de los Muertos. Y siempre nos explicaron que vienen nuestros difuntos en noviembre primero y noviembre 2. Cuando vienen nuestros difuntos, vienen por su luz, para que a donde estén descansando tengan luz. Vienen por su pan, su comida que a ellos les gustaba, mucha fruta típica de la región donde nosotros somos, como el tejocote que acaba de decir mi mamá, que es más o menos una fruta parecida al nanchi. La mandarina, las manzanas, el pan de muertos, muy común en esta época, la flor de cempasúchil, tiene un aroma muy bonito y el aroma también representa para que nuestros difuntos se lleven todo lo bonito que cuando estaban en vida disfrutaron. La luz, como dijimos, a mi abuelito que le gustaba fumar y le gustaba tomar, que no lo hagan, por favor, niños. ¿Qué más? La
Calabaza.
calabaza, también muy común. Nosotros en el pueblo sacábamos la semilla de la calabaza y siempre nos gustó a todos comerlo, entonces también se lo ponemos a nuestros difuntos. Hay otra cosa que no sé qué ahorita que también es copal, como un incienso. El copal tiene un olor hermoso, hermoso, que también a nuestros difuntos se lo ponemos para que ellos se lleven todos los olores que, de nuevo, en vida disfrutaron. Después de ese día se lleva las flores al panteón, como lo dijo mi mamá, las veladoras. En esta época llueve mucho en Morelos, así es que los panteones se llenan de muchas, zacate, mucho pasto, así es que van, lo decoran, pasan tiempo ahí con nuestros difuntos, también le pueden hacer una oración, un rezo, qué más les podía explicar. Y básicamente es algo muy bonito. Por favor, no me gustaría que lo confundieran que es religioso. Sí ponemos las cruces, pero no es nada religioso. Es algo muy significativo de nuestro origen indígenas. Por favor, quiero rectificar eso, que este viene de los aztecas, de todas esas culturas hermosas que tenemos en México, todo lo que lo que ellos hacían también, lo que significaba para ellos. No quiero que se malinterprete en absoluto, de nuevo ponemos la cruz porque somos católicos nosotros, pero no significa nada de religión. Recordamos, pues, como dijo mamá, a mis abuelitos, todos mis tíos, mi papá poniendo una foto y simplemente teniéndolos en nuestros corazones con mucho amor, con mucho respeto. Y pasarle esta tradición a nuestras siguientes generaciones. Me gustaría agradecer mucho a Common Vision Coalition por todo lo que nos han ayudado y para poder pasar nuestras tradiciones a otras generaciones y a otras culturas. A otras culturas, a nuestros niños, que disfrutemos más que nada, disfrutemos y respetemos a todo ser humano, todas las tradiciones. Pacíficamente y de nuevo, muchísimas gracias a ustedes por permitirnos pasar un poquito nuestras tradiciones.
Sí, señora.
También los niños en la noche pasan grita, cantando. La calavera tiene hambre, no hay un pancito por ahí. No se lo de, coman todo, déjenme la mitad. Y ya sale uno, ya les da uno que la frutita. Aquí ya ves, se acostumbra a los dulces.
Sí.
Allá no, de aparte de guarda uno fruta, ya les da uno fruta, que la naranja, que el plátano. Allá hacemos unos, se nombran tlaxcales, son unas gorditas. Y también eso les da uno a los niños y ya se van a otra casa y así andan en las calles gritando, cantando. Y también igual como aquí que se disfrazan, así también allá. Sí.
Gracias.
Hello, today I'm going to be doing a tutorial on this Día de los Muertos look. Here I'm using a makeup kit and I bought it from Amazon, but you can find it at a different store. I am applying the white cream part of the kit onto my face. Then I'm going to put on a second layer so that it's all even and consistent. Here's what I'll be using for the black part for the eye. So first you're going to outline it, carve it out, and then you're going to go back in and fill it in with the black. And it will go above your eyebrow and then just below your eye. And make sure to not fill in the eyelid space with the black, just around it. I'm using the Amorti Therno palette for the eyeshadow look. First, I'm putting concealer so that the colors will come out, and then blending it with the brush. Here I am putting in a red eyeshadow into my crease, and then I am putting a maroon color to darken it, and then using the red again. I am putting darker eyeshadow onto the outer part of my lid and leaving the middle part clear. I'm going to go back in and add a gold shimmer to the middle part. Here I'm putting mascara to prep my eyelashes for the false eyelashes. But you can use just the mascara if you'd like. And then just going in with more mascara to make it more dramatic. Here I'm filling in any missed spaces in the eye. I'm using eyelash glue here to glue on the rhinestones on the outer part of the black. And I'm using the red and black rhinestones, but you can use only red or only black or a different color if you'd like. Here, first I outline the black part, and then after I have the line, I will go back in to darken it. And it doesn't have to be perfect, because once you go back in to darken it, it will come together. Here I'm drawing the lines, and like the last part, first outline them and then go back in to darken it. And you'll bring the lines to the mouth and then they will go onto the lips. Here I am going to be drawing a web on my chin. So you'll draw these lines and connect them to the bottom. And it's okay if you mess up, because afterwards you can go in with the makeup wipe to make the lines thinner. And then after the makeup wipe, you can use the white part of the kit to make the lines more precise. And then just darkening the lines again with the black. Here I'm connecting them, and I put a little bit of a dip in between the lines. Here I am drawing little dots to give more of a design. And then above that I will put glue so I can glue on more of the rhinestones. I'm starting on my nose, and I'm putting the black not all over my nose, but leaving some white on the edges. And then again, if you need to clean it, just use a makeup wipe, and then go in with the white, and then you can define the lines more with the black. Here I'm drawing another web. Here's the finished look. I hope you guys enjoyed this tutorial.
Hello, my name is Robin Contreras, and today I will be presenting my Day of the Dead or Día de los Muertos ofrenda. Día de los Muertos is a celebration that originated in central and southern Mexico. Those who celebrate it believe that at midnight on October 31st, the souls of all deceased children come down from heaven and reunite with their families on November 1st. And the souls of deceased adults come visit on November 2nd. Families make colorful altars in their home in honor of their deceased loved ones, and the altars are decorated with flowers, candles, and their loved ones' favorite foods. The festivities continue in the cemetery, where families bring picnics, play music, and sometimes even spend the night as a way to celebrate the lives of those who are no longer on this earth. We place the photo of the person to whom the altar is dedicated on the top level of the altar in the center. At the top of the altar, there is a photograph of my grandparents. Their names are Emma and Cristobal. To the lower left is my great-grandmother, Carito, and to the lower right is my aunt, Marta, who passed away this year. A glass of water is placed on the ofrenda to quench the thirst of the spirits and serve as a source of life and represents purity. Salt is also present because on the path back home, they may encounter bad spirits. The salt offers them protection and purifies their souls just like the water. Candles represent life, faith, and hope. The flame guides the spirits on their journey. Sometimes four more candles are placed together to form a cross, which represents the cardinal directions so that the spirits can find their way. You can place flowers in a vase or pull the petals out and scatter them all over the surfaces of the altar. If you use cempasúchil or marigolds, the scent will be even stronger if you pull out the petals. The bright colors of the marigolds and their fragrance are synonymous with the Day of the Dead. Fresh flowers remind us of the impermanence of life. Seasonal fruits and special bread called pan de muertos are usually placed on the altar, along with other foods that the person enjoyed in life. Mexicans usually place tamales, mole, and hot chocolate on the altar, but you can use whatever fruit and other foods are available to you. The food is a feast that is laid out for the spirits to enjoy. It is believed that they consume the scent and the essence of the food. I have placed chocolates, tequila, and bread as my altar this month. Thank you.
Buenas tardes. Mi nombre es Josué y hoy vamos a leer unos libros del Día de la Muerte. Celebrating Holidays, Day of the Dead. This book will tell us a little bit about the Day of the Dead. Why is it celebrated? When is it? And stuff like that. So the Day of the Dead is here. Skeletons and colorful calaveras smile out of the windows. These are calaveras. People wear face paint. They play music, dance in the cemeteries. It is Day of the Dead. What is Day of the Dead? Let me tell you. This holiday honors the dead. Families welcome spirits back home. They celebrate death as a part of life. It is a happy time. Now, let's learn some words from in Spanish. How do you say calaveras? You say calaveras. Día de los Muertos is Día de los Muertos. Ofrendas, ofrendas. Pan de muerto, pan de muerto. Papel picado. Papel picado. Papel picado is the little paper that gets cut. I'll point it out when you see some. Who celebrates Day of the Dead? Mexico and other parts of Latin America celebrate this holiday. They call it Día de los Muertos. The United States also enjoys the holiday. Day of the Dead beginnings. People in Mexico started to honor the dead thousands of years ago. Well, that's a long time. They had special months to remember the spirits of the of their loved ones. Today, the holiday combines old traditions with All Saints Day and All Souls Day. These Christian holidays also honor the dead. This is All Saints Day in Poland. Time to celebrate. Day of the Dead is on November 2nd. Children who have died are often remembered the day before. People clean graves and decorate for the celebrations. These are some of the Day of the Dead traditions. Ofrendas are important to Day of the Dead. People create altars to hold candles, photos, and belongings of the dead. If you want to make papel picado, this is the paper we were talking about earlier. Here are some instructions. First, a little background on them. People decorate altars with papel picado, punched paper. What you're going to need is 4 sheets of colored tissue paper, a pencil or marker, and scissors. The first step is to cut 4 different colors of paper into 9-inch by 9-inch rectangles. Then you fold each sheet in half. Then you draw designs on all 4 edges with the pencil or marker. And then you leave a space between each shape so that you can cut out each shape and unfold the papers to see your designs. Families offer water and food to the spirits. Bread of the dead is a common offering. This sweet bread is often decorated with bone shapes. This is a sugar skull. Sugar skulls are also popular. I bet. Who doesn't love sugar, right? Bells ring to call spirits to the festival. People burn incense and put flowers on graves. This is incense. They are happy to remember the dead. A lot of times it's people that are gone and they're happy to remember them. And that does it for this book. The end. Now that you guys know a little bit more about Day of the Dead, let's read this book, The Dead Family Diaz. Today is El Día de los Muertos, and Angelito's knees are knocking. He's never met a real live living person before. And from what his sister tells him, they sound scary. The dead people think the living people are scary. That's funny. Lucky for him, a holiday fiesta is the perfect place to make a new friend. But when Angelito's new buddy isn't quite what he expected, it'll take the traditions of the Day of the Dead to reunite the two boys in time for some holiday fun. They even have a car and a dog. Morning came as the dead sun chased off the dead moon. All across the land of the dead, everyone's spirits were high. Rise and shine, sleepy skulls, Mrs. Diaz called. Breakfast is getting cold. Huevos muertos, cheered Estrellita. Yum! Angelito looked at his plate miserably. Today was the Day of the Dead, when his family would walk among the living. And Angelito was feeling scared. Did I tell you how the living have big red tongues and bulging eyes? His sister jabbered. And if you touch one, they feel all hot and squishy. Is that true? Huh. Ew, gasped Angelito, turning whiter than ever. Mrs. Diaz hushed her daughter. The living are our friends, she said, and this is the one time each year everyone gets together to celebrate. But were they really hot and squishy? Angelito listened in horror to his sister's stories about Halloween, when the living put out fury-eyed pumpkins to scare the dead away. Except it never works, cackled Estrellita. The Day of the Dead is nothing like Halloween, Angelito's father insisted. Now eat up. We don't want to be late. Angelito fed his breakfast to Dante while Estrellita chomped away. Finally, the family piled into the car. That's Dante eating his breakfast. Eating Angelito's breakfast. I told you we should have left earlier, Mr. Diaz grumbled. Just look at this traffic. Nearby, a large crowd was waiting for the elevator to the land of the living. Our land, and the dead were getting restless. Here's the elevator. Quit pushing, numbskull. Tell it to the zombies at the back. Jostled and shoved, the Diaz family squeezed into a packed elevator. Up and up they went until, ding, the doors finally opened. Welcome to the land of the living, a booming voice shouted. Like, they're coming out of the dead, and here are the living, wearing masks of the dead. pushed into the bright world beyond, Angelito froze. Where were his parents? Shouting people, chiming bells, and blaring music drowned out his calls. He darted through the crowd, searching, but his family was nowhere to be found. Finally, Angelito arrived at a quiet square. Spotting a friendly-looking skull, he asked, you didn't see a man when a woman and a bone-headed girl wearing too much jaw gloss passed by, did you? The boy laughed, but shook his head. Angelito began to slump away. I'm Pablo, by the way, the boy called. Did you happen to see any of them yet? Them, he means the living, Angelito thought. He told Pablo all about the terrible shouting he'd heard near the elevators. They must be getting ready to attack, whispered Pablo. Let's get out of here. The pair scrambled behind a fruit and vegetable stand where Angelito came up with a plan. They tip over a box of cherries so their enemies would slip. And then we can finish them off with these, Pablo suggested, handing over a few tomatoes. Before long, they heard an angry mob approaching. Get ready, whispered Angelito. Aim. Wait, hold your fire, cried Pablo. It wasn't a mob at all, but a parade full of banging drums and blasting trumpets. Still, Pablo warns that some of them might be hiding in it. Maybe we should keep our masks on just in case. Masks? Laughed the skeleton boy. What masks? These ones, silly, said Pablo, reaching for Angelito's face. Hey, you're as cold as a popsicle, he squealed. And you've got bulging eyes, cried Angelito. Ah, you're one of them, they both shouted. He thought he was one of him, and he thought he was one of him. Angelito took off, tearing down streets and alleyways without looking back. Out of breath, he finally stopped. Had he really been playing with a living boy the whole time? How freaky, he shuddered. How icky, how awful, but how incredibly fun, he had to admit. Except now he was alone again. Feeling glum, Angelito wandered around the deserted town until he found himself at the cemetery gates. Inside, a big party was going on. There was a loud bark. Dante, Angelito cried, rushing over to his family. He found them. Mrs. Diaz squeezed her son so tightly he thought he might crack. Angelito told them how he'd gotten lost and had been looking for them all day. We're just glad you're safe, sighed his father. Now let's get to the buffet. I'm ready to stuff my rib cage. Estrita slid up to her brother.
Oh, I bet you were so scared, she whispered gleefully, all alone in the land of the living.
Actually, I wasn't alone, Angelito said. Then, spotting a familiar face, the dead boy discovered that he didn't need guts to be brave.
Hey, Pablo, wait up,
Angelito called. The living boy turned, then a big smile crossed his face. Sorry for saying you had bulging eyes, said Angelito.
Sorry for calling you a popsicle, Pablo replied.
So we're cool again? Angelito asked, grinning a big skeleton grin. Pablo winked. Cool as your bones. You got a comedian. Angelito told Pablo all the things Estrita had said to make him scared of the living. She's okay, mostly, he admitted. But sometimes she can be a real knucklebone. Maybe she just needs to meet a real living boy up close, Pablo said. Uh-oh, what are they planning?
Pablo is scaring the sister.
The dead moon had already chased off the dead sun by the time the dead family Diaz returned home. Bone tired, Angelito headed to bed where he dreamed sweet dreams. The Day of the Dead. The end. So just to recap, the Day of the Dead, El Día de los Muertos, is a holiday celebrated in Mexico on November 1st, when it is believed that the spirits of the dead return to visit the living. Though it is always sad when people die, the Day of the Dead is a happy holiday, a time for people to remember and appreciate friends and relatives who have passed on. The day is full of singing, dancing, and feasting. Special displays known as altars are made to welcome these beloved souls into the homes of their living family, with food laid out for the spirits to enjoy when they visit. The end. Look how much fun they had. Well, I want to thank you for joining me, and I hope you learned something and you enjoyed the story. I will see you guys later. Bye-bye.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Tom Fontanis. I'm a docent at the Lincoln Memorial Shrine. I was asked by the staff there to do an ofrenda for the Day of the Dead celebration based on the life of Lincoln. Here's my ofrenda table, and it represents different elements. Every ofrenda table has certain consistent elements. One thing, people think of Day of the Dead, they think of the Walking Dead or something gothic or Halloween, and it's not. Day of the Dead represents the ancestors and the family of loved ones and family of people getting together at the end of time, and this is an earthly representation of it. Each ofrenda has basically the same elements. You see ones with different sizes, different levels. This one has two, representing earth and heaven, the physical realm and the spiritual realm. One of the elements, or one of the factors in it, is every ofrenda has represented in it the four elements: earth, air, wind, and fire. The wind are the papel picado, which is just basically cut paper, and it's cut to represent different elements of the Day of the Dead. That's the wind, the air. Earth is the fruit. You have always fruit at the table, which represents, it's like a snack sort of for the spirits that they come, and that because it comes from the earth. Fire are the candles. We have six of them represented with angels from the shrine itself, one of the Dean of Cornwall art that he represented. And the water is the vase. The vase is basically just water, just like the fruit, and it's supposed to represent when the spirits come, that they have something to drink, almost like Santa Claus at Christmas and even milk and cookies. The pan de muertos, the bread of the dead, it's consistent in everyone. All the tables, all the ofrendas have. Mine was, of course, it's not related to me, but it was supposed to be Lincoln. And these are the different elements of Lincoln's life. This is his wife, Mary Todd Lincoln. Lincoln actually had four sons. He had, the youngest one was Edward. He died at 4 years old. And then William, he died, he was about 12 years old. He died in the White House. He died of typhus, or this theory, I think it was typhus. And the other one was Ted. He died after Lincoln's assassination. He was 18 years old when he passed away. The other son was Robert Todd. He was the firstborn. He died in 1926 at the age of 83. So you can imagine all of the heartbreak that Mary Todd went through, all the three dead sons during her life before she passed away, and then seeing her husband assassinated. These are some of the little personal items. This is a bust of Lincoln and another little medal of Lincoln as a congressman. The flowers here, since it was Lincoln, red, white, and blue, these basically would represent the marigold, which is the flower of the Day of the Dead. Marigold is supposed to be so fragrant, and that would draw the spirits to their particular table. The upper level over here is a picture of Lincoln. You would have a picture of a loved one. And they were heirlooms. They were passed on. They're still passed down from generation to generation as they keep the different ofrendas during different generations. And I've always been partial to photos of Lincoln without the beard. Some people really like the beard. Just a crucifix. And of the elements, the one I think I neglected to mention maybe was fire, and this is what the candles are the five. The two skeletons in the back with the skulls are represented. This is the colors of Mexico, red, green, and white, and the colors of Guatemala, which is blue and white. And the background over here is a collage I did representing the life of Lincoln, his coffin. The two things that Lincoln are known for is the preserver of the Union and the great emancipator, the Emancipation Proclamation. The Pope Wanted poster after he was assassinated, a picture of Lincoln on his deathbed with generals around him and different loved ones and family, and just different elements. The picture, the classic picture of Lincoln with his beard, two pictures when he was younger, still not president, and these two are they're known as the lunettes. They're in the Lincoln Shrine. And a Norman Rockwell painting, the great Lincoln on his birthday. Now it's known as the Long Shadow of Lincoln. But this is just my humble representation of the Day of the Dead. You'll probably see other ofrendas, and they'll present what they mean to the particular people. And I just thank you. Enjoy your Day of the Dead, and hope you enjoy all the other ofrendas. Thank you very much.
Hi there. My name is Kate Pretorius, and I am a member of the Redlands branch of the American Association of University Women. AAUW is the nation's leading voice promoting equity in education for women and girls. Since our founding in 1881, AAUW members have examined and taken positions on the fundamental issues of the day: educational, social, economic, and political. Membership is open to anyone holding an associate, bachelor, or higher degree from an accredited college or university. Students enrolled in a 2 or 4 year institution may become student affiliates. In principle and in practice, AAUW values and seeks a diverse membership. There shall be no barrier to full participation in this organization on the basis of gender, race, creed, age, sexual orientation, national origin, or physical ability. During this season of remembering those who have come before us, we honor the group of visionary women who founded AAUW 139 years ago. In 1881, Marion Talbot, then a recent graduate of Boston University, and Ellen Swallow Richards, the first woman graduate of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, invited 15 alumna from 8 colleges to a meeting in Boston. Among the first generation of women college graduates, these pioneering women struggled with a lack of career opportunity. In founding AAUW, they discussed how they would join together to help other women break through educational barriers and attend and graduate college, as well as to assist those who had already graduated. The rest is history. Today, AAUW boasts 170,000 members and supporters, more than 100 student organizations, 800 college and university members, and more than $100 million awarded to women scholars and projects. When we created our ofrenda for last year's event, we wanted to remember and honor the brave women who fought for the passage of the 19th Amendment, granting women the right to vote. Many AAUW members were active in the effort, including Mary Woolley, president of Mount Holyoke College, Anna Kelton Wiley, and Maud Wood Park. Redlands' own Mary Hamilton was also a vocal advocate for suffrage and an AAUW member. The suffragists were known for their sashes and badges, as well as their iconic graphics held high to promote their cause. We included a ballot box and ballots, a tea service, and biscuits. Too many of the suffragists' names are lost to history, but we want to honor and give thanks to all of these brave and honorable women.
My name is Ingrid Sanchez, and I am a member of CHAT, which stands for Conversation Helps Adult Transitions. Working with volunteers from the American Association of Women, or AAUW, CHAT gives well-educated women from other countries the opportunity to practice their conventional English. 18 countries are represented in CHAT. CHAT members have the wonderful opportunity to discuss how different countries celebrate traditions differently. I am originally from Venezuela. In Venezuela, we celebrate Dia de los Muertos by visiting cemeteries and putting flowers on the graves of our families and friends. Afterwards, we may share a meal with our families. Other South and Central American countries like Colombia, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Honduras, and El Salvador have similar traditions for honoring loved ones who have passed. It has been fascinating to learn about the Mexican tradition of Dia de los Muertos. The 2019 Chat Altar or Ofrenda was designed by two of our chat members, Socorro Contreras and Sandra Godoy. The ofrenda has three tiers, which represents heaven, earth, and the underworld, which is the world of the dead. The front of the table was decorated with paper cutouts from Mexico. The cutouts highlight Dia de los Muertos, which occurs on November 2nd. The first layer of the table was decorated with paper marigold flowers and apples, candies, and breads. Food and drink are put on the table to invite loved ones who have passed to return to visit the living on Dia de los Muertos. Chat members Dorothy Norquist, Trudy Waldrum, and Catherine Gifford brought pictures of family members who have passed, who they wished to honor. Pictures of Frida Kahlo and Mario Moreno, whose professional name was Cantinflas, were also placed on the ofrenda. The candles, skulls, and cross reflect traditional elements of the ofrendas. I have learned that the traditions associated with Dia de los Muertos can connect us to our ancestors, which can be a great comfort to families. We hope that Dia de los Muertos tradition reminds you of your own family traditions, which help you to share precious memories of loved ones who have passed. Thank you.
Susan Sorden's fascination with China led her to a teaching assignment there, where she would meet her future husband, Walter. She was on the faculty of the University of Redlands and is remembered for her commitments to family, students, and the university. She was a member of the Friends Board and gave much of her time in support of the bookstore and the silent auction. Her energy and dry sense of humor is missed on Monday mornings. Brenda Bean's great joy was relaxing at the beach. She was a passionate supporter of music and arts in Redlands. When her career as an educator was done, she turned her professional skills toward volunteerism, becoming a devoted tutor in the adult literacy program. She was also a generous donor to adult literacy, providing future learners with workbooks and other materials. The Friends know a couple of things about Mrs. Valentine. She loved the library, and she had a plan to support the growth and quality of its collections and services. The very generous donation we received from Mrs. Valentine's estate was a bit of a mystery, albeit a wonderful one, as her connection to the Friends is unknown, but we are deeply grateful for her generosity. Mike Henry was a proud California Polytechnic University Pomona alumnus. He enjoyed reading James Patterson novels, loved to travel, to golf, and play bridge. As a dedicated member of the Friends Board, he generously shared his professional expertise in finance to serve as treasurer. The Friends miss him and are deeply grateful for his service. Ray Robinson was a member of the Friends Board and served as its president. He is credited with creating the Friends Bookstore, now the largest library bookstore in Southern California. Because Ray was willing to put the time toward this dream of a bookstore, the Friends can use the funds raised for library maintenance and to purchase new books, support programs like the Children's Summer Reading Event, and adult literacy. We are grateful for Ray's vision and dedication. Tim Green loved to dress in the style of Sherlock Holmes. He loved classic movies and was always delighted to find one still shrink-wrapped at the Friends Bookstore. Tim and his wife Pam were frequent customers at the bookstore, and they often supported the Friends' weekly auction and special sales. A true gentleman, Tim always had a kind word and a smile for Friends' volunteers. Tom Taylor was a decorated Vietnam War veteran and organized events in the area to support and thank other vets. Because he wanted all the children of Redlands to have access to books, he established the Tom Taylor Children's Book Fund in collaboration with the Friends of the Library and the Family Service Association. We appreciate Tom and his service to the nation and to Redlands. Wanda Hale loved gardening, sewing, knitting, fishing, and making delicious lemon meringue pies to share with her neighbors. She was a past president of the Board of Realtors and very active in service to the Redlands community as a member of the Contemporary Club, Salvation Army Board, and the Congregational Church. She was a faithful and generous donor to the Adult Literacy Program.
My name is Socorro Contreras. In 2019, Sandra Godoy and I designed the Dia de los Muertos, or Day of the Dead Altar, for the Adult Literacy Program. The Redlands Adult Literacy Program assists adults in our community who wants to improve their reading and writing in English. I have been a student in the Adult Literacy Computer classes. When I was asked to explain the story of the Dia de los Muertos, I shared this story from my childhood. I heard Carito, my grandmother, screaming at me from the kitchen, "Cachito, wake up now. We have to go to the market." "I already prepared your breakfast," she said. "We have little time to prepare everything for the altar of the Day of the Dead," she said loudly. I ran to the kitchen and ate everything Carito had prepared for me. She was already started to leave us. I finished brushing my teeth. "Ready? We can go," I said. We arrived at the market, and Carito began to buy everything that was necessary for the altar. First, we bought candles to light the way so the souls of the dead could come back home like they do every year. On the Day of the Dead, we welcome our loved ones who have already passed. Then, we bought marigolds to decorate and mark the path that the souls of the deceased must follow. We have to buy the food, the sweets, and the drinks that the souls liked the most, Carito said. Carito turned to me and said in a loud voice, "And remember, Cachito, that nothing is eaten or touched into the day the souls of our deceased live." She continued, "Let's not forget to buy the tissue paper and the sugar skull." I asked Carito, "What are the sugar skull and tissue paper for?" She replied, "As far as I know, each color has a meaning for each soul, and the sugar skull reminds us that we are all going to die someday." She said this very seriously. When we got home, we started preparing our altar. My mother also started to help us, and she told me, "You can bring the glasses of water and the soul cross that are in the kitchen, please." I asked what the soul cross and glasses of water were for. My mother answered me, "Well, the water is to quench the thirst the souls have, and the soul is to clean and purify their way back to our home." My mom and Carito hugged me and thanked me for my help. We went to bed, because 3 days of celebration await us. On November 1st, we honor the children who have died. On November 2nd, adults who have passed all celebrate. And on November 10th, we could celebrate my birthday. November is my favorite month.
This is Kate Pretorius, and I'm a current member of the Board of Trustees of the A.K. Smiley Public Library. In creating our ofrenda last year, we wanted to honor those 45 generous Redlands community members who gave generously of their time and talent to ensure the future success of the A.K. Smiley Public Library. At the very top, you'll see the library as it looked in 1901. Beneath that is a photo from 1915 with Stuart Hodgkiss, Charles Putnam, Daniel Smiley, Artina Chapin, who was the librarian, L. Worthington Green, Willard Nichols, and Kirk Field. Beneath that is a photo from 1925 of J.J. Pendergast, E.M. Lyon, Kirk Field, and Stuart Hodgkiss. The next photo down was taken in 1934 on the occasion of the 40th anniversary of the founding of Smiley Library. In the back row is Lyman King, Miss Mabel Innes, the librarian, J.J. Pendergast, Stuart Hodgkiss. Seated is Kirk Field, Mrs. Daniel Smiley, and Eldridge Lyon. Beneath these photographs, behind a very scary spider, is a list and the terms of the 45 trustees who have preceded us in leadership of the library. You'll note that all of this is placed on a window, which dates to the original building before the administrative wing was added in 1990.
Greetings on this Dia de los Muertos. I am Rosa Gomez, Vice President of the A.K. Smiley Library Board of Trustees. Along with Trustee Kate Pretorius, we wanted to honor past trustees who have moved on to the spiritual world. Our altar includes many items used to enhance the journey on this Dia de los Muertos. In addition to those items described by Trustee Kate Pretorius, we have included the following. The marigolds. This flower is significant for its scent and bright orange blossoms. It is believed that it helps attract souls to the altar. The skulls, or calaveras, are elegantly and colorfully decorated female and male skulls. They represent those that have passed and who are receiving the offerings. We have included colorful paper cutouts, papel picado. It is believed the holes in the paper allow the souls to travel through and visit. It also symbolizes the fragility of life. The cookies that you see here would be included as something that the hungry souls that are arriving would be able to partake in. Now the flickering candle, it is lit to welcome the spirits back to their altars. And we've also included other cultural objects. These were created by artisans and represent important aspects of the spiritual and cultural life in the Latino community. The trustees and I wish you and your family a feliz Dia de los Muertos. Thank you so much.